Happy to see you guys again. And later, Adido will give a speech about building orchestration and configuration with Ansible at Fedora project. So let's welcome.
Thank you. Shishi, right? Thank you, Shishi, right? Yeah. Okay, I'm trying to learn. Let's see how much Mandarin I can, you know, speak up by the end of the session. I'm Aditya. I am Fedora ambassador, and I contribute to the infrastructure project of Fedora. That means that I work for a team where we look after the servers and network on which Fedora runs. Okay. Right. How many of you know what's a system administrator? Okay, good. What's a system administrator?
Sorry?
What's a system administrator? Do you know? Okay, anyone else? What's a system administrator?
You mean an orchestrator or something else?
That word.
Yeah, system administrator.
Yeah. So a system administrator is the one who looks after the systems. For example, your servers, your networks, your routers. Okay, so he is the one who's the in charge of the entire infrastructure, you know, services and what all goes and comes. Cool. Okay, so we are going to talk a bit about the challenges, the problems which are faced by system administrator. Okay, we are going to talk about why scripts, you know, maybe shell scripts or Python scripts, they fail to scale when you talk about a very big infrastructure, right? Then we are going to see how Ansible helps us in solving those problems. Okay, and then we are also going to see how previous tools like Puppet and Chef have, you know, tried to solve the same problem, but there were some gaps around it, okay, which Ansible has hopefully tried to fill up, right? Okay, then I'm gonna try to give you some, you know, some code snippet, like how you can run ad hoc commands using Ansible and how you can run, you know, well-defined structured code blocks to, you know, build up your servers as fast as possible. Okay, and then we are going to see some benefits like centralization and how we use Ansible at Fedora project and how you guys can help us in making Ansible or, you know, infrastructure at Fedora even better, right? So I need your help to make, you know, Fedora go to the next level. We need all of you to help us. Right, so that's like the system administrator guy. He's always trapped in a wheel, you know, the wheel keeps on rotating and he's never able to come out. Reason, because what happens is that as new servers come in, as new routers applications come in, we are always doing the same repetitive thing. It's like stuck in a loop. You guys know what infinite loop is, right? Infinite loop. Yeah, so it's mostly like that we keep on doing that same stuff again and again, and it never just finishes. Okay, plus these days there is like a different concept of cloud infrastructure, co-located infrastructure. Some people have physical servers, some people have virtual machines, some people have mix of both. So managing them requires a different kind of strategy. The way you manage a cloud-based infrastructure is very different than the way you manage a co-located or a physical hardware-based infrastructure, right? You guys know what's the difference between cloud-based infrastructure and, you know, physical infrastructure, right? Okay. And with all the, you know, invention of these things, we have other problems. Like, for example, you guys must be having a website of the college, right? Behang University, you guys would be having a website for the college. Now, or let me take a better example. What's the website which you guys use most frequently? Which one? QQ? I heard QQ is quite popular.
WeChat.
Okay, yeah, WeChat. So you guys use WeChat a lot?
Yes.
Right? So now imagine that WeChat is having, you know, maybe 100 servers to cater to the traffic of all of you. And now one day, a lot of people decide that, okay, we should also try WeChat. Now what will happen there? They'll need much more servers to handle all the extra traffic, right? So in that scenario, we want those extra servers to be as identical to the previous ones as possible. They should be same as the previous one, just so that they can handle the traffic in more homogeneous sense. Okay? So Ansible helps in all this. Right. So why scripts fail to scale? When you have such problems of provisioning and all, you would always think, okay, maybe I should write a shell script, or maybe Python or Perl, right? But eventually you'll realize that these scripts, they become very difficult after a certain point if you don't document them well. Documentation is a big problem in entire development community. Entire developer community just hates to document, including me. I just hate to document. And that what happens is that today I didn't document, and maybe after 6 months, when somebody else would look at that code, he'll get totally confused that what's going on. And after a year, even I'm gonna be confused that what did I write 1 year ago? It will be very, very confusing for me. Okay. How many of you have any experience with Perl?
Perl programming language.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. So if you have written Perl, you know how dirty it can be. It will be almost impossible to understand Perl beyond 50 lines or 100 lines, something like that. With scripts is also another problem that you end up repeating a lot of code, right? So for example, if you're working on a cloud and if you want to write a script to bring up a machine, right? What will happen is that by default, by natural thinking, you will end up putting the authentication code on all the scripts, which is not a good idea. Probably you should write a library and then try to import that library everywhere. So that's yet another thing which you should keep in mind. Also, you need to remember the order of execution, right? How many of you have ever set up a simple web server and hosted a website? WordPress or something like that? Joomla, Drupal, anything, right? So there has to be an order of execution, right? First, you have to install the database. You have to install HTTPD, the Apache server. Then you have to install PHP. Then only you can turn on the website, right? You cannot break this order. You cannot say try to install PHP first and then HTTPD, because that will just not work. So you have to remember this order of execution, that how everything has to be ordered in the sense that otherwise it will just not work. You have to maintain the order. Right, so now what do we do? How does Ansible help us? Ansible, first of all, it uses YAML. Does anybody know what's YAML? Close. That was the older definition. I think they changed it recently. It's YAML ain't markup language, something like that. Anyways, that was the previous one. So what YAML does is, YAML helps you to read the code very easily. So it solves the problem of documentation. I'll show you a YAML file in the end of it. Okay. And if you guys, you guys can read it yourself, and you'll realize that how easy it is that without absolute knowledge of Ansible, you can understand what is written there and what the script is going to do, okay? Ansible uses OpenSSH as transport protocol. You guys must be familiar with SSH, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, everybody would be familiar with SSH. So Ansible uses OpenSSH as protocol, which helps a lot because all the Linux servers come with OpenSSH, right? All the Linux servers have OpenSSH pre-installed, so you don't need to install anything extra. Then it has parallel ordered execution. So by parallel ordered, I mean to say that you can run it parallelly on n number of servers. You don't need to set up servers one by one. Okay. And ordered in the sense that after step one, it will go to step two, it will go to step three. So you don't need to remember that, okay, PHP has to be installed after HTTPD, because Ansible will take care of that for you, right? It reduces your task. And last one is the best part. You do not need to have any agent running on the server. So if you have used any other tool like Puppet or Chef, then what happens is that you need to have an agent running on the server, which will be listening. And when you fire something from the Puppet Master or Chef, the agent will get the message and they'll talk, and then the changes will go through. With Ansible, there's no such thing. There's no need of an agent. All Ansible requires is OpenSSH, right? And Python. Both of them are default in almost all the Linux on this planet, at least. It comes with everything, right? Okay. Let's see. Let's take a minute. Do you guys have any questions so far before I move on to the next one? Any questions? Okay. Right. So, if you guys have worked with Puppet or Chef before, then this slide would be relevant to you. The difference between Puppet Chef versus Ansible would be mostly that A, Ansible doesn't need any agent. So that makes life very easier, because as soon as your machine is up, you're ready to use it. You do not need to install an agent first. Okay? So that reduces your task. It speeds up the entire provisioning methodology. Your machines are ready to use much faster than they would have been with Puppet or Chef. Other thing is that since Ansible is based on Python, it's possible to use Ansible on virtualization hypervisors like Xen. Right? Citrix Xen, if you would have heard of it. Citrix Xen, Ansible can run over Citrix Xen and other hypervisors. It's not possible to run, at least no straightforward way to run Chef or Puppet on Xen based servers. YAML is a lot easier to read. I'll show you an example in some time. So you'll know that the need of documentation reduces a lot with YAML. So like I say, I'm not an expert on this field. If you guys have any inputs, any ideas around it, or maybe I'm wrong somewhere, you guys are most welcome to correct me. Okay. Okay, so now let's get to work. How do you install Ansible? Right, it's very easy. It's packaged for almost all the distributions. You can use yum, you can use apt, you can use pip if you do not have yum or apt. Pip install Ansible, yum install Ansible, everything will work. You do not need to set up transport separately. As long as if you can SSH to your remote machines, you can run Ansible on your remote machines. Okay. Now there are two ways to get work done using Ansible. One is known as ad hoc, and another one is known as scripted. Okay. So with ad hoc, what you can do is, say if you have a collection of servers, okay. For example, say you have 10 database servers. Okay. So you can run a particular command on all the 10 database servers, on any collection of servers. If you want to run anything ad hoc, for example, you just want to see how much disk size is left. So that's an ad hoc command. You can just run it via ad hoc commands. If you want to do some scripted stuff, for example, if you want to set up a new server, or if you want to upgrade a new server, maybe upgrade a collection of servers. Then you can go for scripted commands. So in scripted, we make a script, we call it playbook. Okay, so we make a playbook and then we just execute it. It will be applied on all the servers in that particular group or cluster, whatever you choose to call it. And then it's done. Inventory file is that file where we define all the groups, all the clusters. I'm just going to show you an example of inventory file. So, yep, this is an example inventory file. As you can see, I have defined three groups here: web servers, databases, and SMTP. Okay. One server can be a part of more than one group. For example, you can have one server which is running SMTP as well as HTTP. That's possible. And one server can be part of multiple groups, as well as there can be there can be multiple servers in a group. Both will work. You can use regular expressions as well here. Okay. So for example, you don't want to write 1, 2 separately, or maybe you have a very long list, then you can just use regular expression like D stands for digit, and you can use it like that. You don't need to define every machine one by one. Okay, any questions till now?
You have two database servers, so practically, so if you have two database servers, sometimes we need to master and slave, or slave master and manage masters, or such kind of different role. So can we do such kind of things with Ansible?
Okay, I'll just repeat the question. The question is that there are times when there are different configurations in a database, like master, master, slave, master, right?
Yeah.
And you want to know if that is possible to manage via Ansible.
Yes.
Right? Okay. Yes, it is possible. So Ansible, so okay, let's drill down to the problem. Problem is that I will have two servers. One could be master, one could be slave, right? How do you define master and slave? You have a different config for master and a different config file for slave. Right? In master's config file, you will set master equal to true. In slave's config file, you will set slave master equal to and the IP of the master. Right? That's how it works. Right? Okay. So now what you can do is, so in Ansible, there's something known as templates. So using template, you can tell Ansible that if a particular machine, which is acting as master, has asked you for a particular configuration, then you can serve only that configuration. So now you can have multiple templates. One would be a master template and another would be a bunch of slave templates. So let's talk about the scenario where there is one master and maybe tens of slaves, right? Which is typically the case in big organizations. Even at Fedora, we have replication mode. So what we do is that there is one master. We serve the master configuration via Puppet with the help of templates and variables. And rest of the machines which act as slave, they get the configuration of slave using their hostname. So when the hostname which matches with slave asks for the configuration, we serve the slave configuration. Okay? Right? Okay. Any other questions? Okay, let's move ahead. Okay, so this is how we do the cluster grouping, right? Okay, so this is just an example of how would I run a simple ad hoc command. So if I have to see what all machines are alive in my inventory, I'm just gonna do this. So here what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to ping all the web servers that are alive. Okay, so minus M stands for a module. So what it's telling is it's asking Ansible to use ping module on all the web servers. Remember, we just defined web servers here. So it's gonna run the ping module on all of these two servers. And if the machines are alive, I will get a POM. Right? So for every ping, I will get a POM if the machine is alive. Cool? Again, yet another example. So here what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to send a command, an ad hoc command to the machines, to all the machines actually. All is a keyword which means everything that is listed in the inventory. Okay? So what I'm trying to do is I'm using the module named command, and to that module I'm passing a command known as echo hello. Right? All of you know what echo command does? Echo command will just echo whatever you say to it. Okay? So now when I did echo hello, all the servers replied to me. Hello, 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 hello. All the commands were successful, and this is the return code. RC stands for return code. Right? Any questions, guys?
Right, so the question he asked is, what if one of the servers failed?
Right? Good question. What will happen if one of the servers failed? Okay, if one of the servers failed, the command will not be executed on that particular server, and it will return with the appropriate message. For example, there could be, so failure can be a lot of things, right? Failure could be failure to communicate to the server. Failure could be failure to execute that particular command, right? There could be many other scenarios of failures. So an appropriate message will be, you know, displayed here. For example, if it failed to communicate, then it will tell you that connection not established or something like that. If the command exited with a non-zero response code, then this will change, which will signify that command failed to execute. Okay? So rest of the servers will still, the command will be executed on the rest of the servers nonetheless, but it will particularly, it will show you the messages, all the error messages will it get. Right? Okay. This is an example of a playbook. Okay? Let's see. I need a volunteer from audience. Anybody who's willing to help me? It'll take 2 minutes. Come on. Anybody? Or I will volunteer myself if you guys don't. Come on, guys. One guy who would help me in explaining this. I need your help. Anybody? Yeah, come on. Come on. Okay. See, this is, I think, first time you're reading this configuration, right?
Yeah. It's for the MySQL database. You define a task. The name is pull config. Maybe you won't update the MySQL config.
Right.
So you copy, there is, what do you do? Copy the config, copy the MySQL config, and then notify. Notify means to restart MySQL to take it back.
Mm-hmm.
That's what do you do, I think.
Yeah, go ahead. It's good. Come down. What does that do?
here is, when you update MySQL, you have a notify here, so it will be a call handled. Yeah, it will be a run a command to service MySQL DB restart.
Right, that's absolutely right. So you just explained an Ansible playbook to everyone. So I think it deserves a... Right, so what's happening here is that I'm just putting a config from my destination to the required destination, that is etc mysql my.com, and once I have copied my
configuration file, I'm going to notify Ansible that it needs to restart MySQL, right? So once you have made any changes to the configuration, you need to restart the application. And how will it restart? It will check the handlers it has. Handler has a handler named restart MySQL, and the command is service MySQL restart, right? So is it difficult to understand? Right, you guys have read it for the first time, and he explained it to you very nicely.
Sorry, but I have a question about this, because if you made some changes on mycircle.conf, and you run the script to take effect, mycircle will be restarted. At next time, it will be run again. It means whether mycircle service will be restarted again.
Okay. Right. Good question. So, okay, if I understand your question right, you're asking that what will happen if we run this script again? Will it restart it again?
Yeah.
Right. So what it's going to do is, Ansible will not restart it again. It will not even copy it again. If the checksum of the source and destination are equal.
Yeah.
Okay. If and only if there are changes to be propagated, then only it will restart it. Okay. Right. Make sense? Okay. Awesome. Let's go ahead. Right. So, decentralization. Like I already said that with Ansible, what happens is that you can decentralize everything. So you do not need to maintain a specific server from where Ansible will run. Ansible can run out of anywhere. I run Ansible from my laptop all the time to the production servers. No harm done. Okay. Anyone who has the right kind of authorization. By right kind of authorization, I mean anyone who can manually run the command on the remote server can also run the command using Ansible. Right? So basically your authorization is managed by the OS, by the Linux OS itself. It could be PAM, it could be LDAP or whatever, right? So you have one server less to manage, and it works from any time. It works anytime, anywhere. You do not need to, you know, be able to log into a central server and then do stuff. You can do it from anywhere. Right, cool. So how we are doing stuff at Fedora Infra? We were using Puppet before Ansible, and once the Ansible got introduced, it got stable enough, we have started using it. We aren't using it fully because a lot of our automation is still in Puppet, and we want more contributors, more people like you who can help us to, you know, reach the stage where we can say goodbye to Puppet, right? We are still in the transition state where we use both.
Why do you want to say goodbye to Puppet?
Yeah, that has been covered. Sorry, you were not here. Okay. Why do we want to say goodbye to Puppet?
In two sentences.
Yeah. So first, Ansible uses only Python and OpenSSH, which comes with all the Linux servers. We do not need to install anything separately. Ansible is agentless. I do not need to have an agent. With Puppet, I would need to install Ruby. I would need to install Puppet agent. And there is a key signing process, which is a nightmare in itself. If you guys are interested in knowing about key signing of Puppet, then we can talk maybe after the talk, right? Right, so we are in a stage where we are trying to, you know, transfer all the automation from Puppet to Ansible. Now, writing something from scratch is not that difficult as compared to writing, you know, understanding something which is already written and writing it again. So we are at that juncture that we read Puppet modules and then we try to transfer it to Ansible, which has its own problems. So if you guys are interested, we can work on that. We focus a lot on idempotent playbooks. So idempotency means that you can run it as many times as you want. And if the state change should not take place, then it will not take place. Right? state of the machine is very important here. So idempotency has to be maintained. It's turbocharged with accelerated mode. So by default, as I already said, that OpenSSH is the protocol which we use, but there is an accelerated mode which can be used with Ansible. So what accelerated mode does is that it spawns a daemon as soon as the first connection happens, and that daemon is now then used for subsequent communication. The daemon is AES encrypted, so your communication is still very safe, but it considerably speeds up the things, right? And with Fedora, as with Puppet, we have made a lot of mistakes. We do make mistakes with Ansible at times. So more people who are able to contribute to infra can point out to those mistakes. And so basically, it's the same strategy with open source, that more eyeballs on a bug actually helps easier. It actually makes it easier to point it out. So in case you guys want to join, you guys want to help us out, we will help you to teach what not to do and what to do, and maybe we'll learn a lot from your experiences as well. Okay. And how do you contribute to Fedora infrastructure project? Basically, what you can so we are, I think, as was mentioned by keynote today, we are the first. We are one of the leading users of Ansible. So if you guys have any problems, I think Fedora will be able to help you out. We need a lot of help in porting these modules from Puppet to Ansible. So we need you. We may have a FAD sometime soon. FAD is Fedora Activity Day, where we will focus on the migrations. Just migrating Puppet modules to Ansible playbooks. So if you guys want to attend that FAD, you're most welcome to do that.